I'm Adrian Dobrița, head of engineering and core developer at Errond. And today, I'm going to try to answer together with you at the question, is scalability a necessity for adoption? But before this, let's take a look at what's the state of affairs for blockchain right now. So we can see that there are several projects with real usability but limited performance. There are also lots of projects that promised a lot but failed to deliver. There are some interesting solutions to scalability and interoperability coming up. There are some countries regulating blockchain and cryptocurrencies. And we can also see some industry initiative in playing around or experimenting with blockchain technology. Now, we can try to look this from a different perspective, and one of the tools that helps us make sense of where this technology is going beyond the hype is through Gartner's technology hype cycle. And here we can identify several key points, like the innovation trigger, which was Bitcoin in 2009, and then peak of inflated expectations was reached with all the ICOs built on Ethereum and all the startups that raised an insane amount of money, but afterwards failed to deliver. And then came the cleansing period where people lost money. The investment in crypto was much more rational and reserved. This has been, I think, 2018, the trough of disillusionment. But now I think we're really at an interesting time where the technology has matured. There's active research being done from in universities, and also we can see that inside companies, there some of the companies have special divisions who are experimenting with blockchain. So for everyone who came later in the space, this is really a good time to try building something on blockchain. Let's check also what's so special about blockchain, because currently we're still not there with the adoption. So what is the value proposition? It's a transfer of value in a decentralized setting that removes the need of a trusted third party. Also, you have immutability that improves integrity and accountability. Intrinsically, it has also resistance to data loss through decentralization, and also it allows for automated contractual procedures. But this has been valid since Bitcoin. So I think the main issue, and maybe lots of you agree with me, are that the poor scalability is a problem, because we've seen enterprises trying to develop proof of concepts, but not any of those have been materialized into a working application or working solution. Also, there are application developers currently. Most of them, I think, are on Ethereum blockchain, but if you check the statistics for the application developed and what is their usage currently, I think the numbers are really low. So most of this, I think, are due to the scalability, because you cannot, for example, if you try to do an application for machine-to-machine transactions, then you cannot do that with 15 transactions per second. There's also the regulatory uncertainty, but as engineers, we try to solve the issues that we have an impact on and we can tackle. So we started in 2017, we wanted to solve scalability. So we came up with a solution that involved two main points. One of them was adaptive state sharding, and the other one's secure proof of stake. For adaptive state sharding, what it's basically a transaction on the level of storage and data, sharding on the level of storage and data, on the level of transaction or computation to execute transactions in parallel, so you can improve the throughput. There's also what we are trying to do, also sharding on the network and communication level. but we are trying to do this adaptively. This means that we can maintain the same security in every single shard. So if, for example, you have nodes leaving the network, then this does not affect the security of a shard. For the secure proof of stake, it's actually the consensus model, which is based on a BFT-like consensus with proof of stake for civil prevention and also eliminating the computational waste. We're doing random sampling of consensus groups inside the shard, and also we have a rating mechanism through which we can slightly increase chances for validators to be selected to produce blocks. For the sharding design, we have a meta chain, which is basically in charge of notarizing everything that happens inside the regular shards. And this also helps with synchronizing between shards and the cross-shard operations, and also gives us, for example, control over the events that can happen in the network. Like I mentioned before, we are adaptive, so there are certain events that happen where we can reorganize the network, so splitting events. This is the way we add new shards in the network, or merging events where we remove all shards when we decrease to below a certain number of nodes. There's also reshuffling. This is mainly done to prevent, in a certain measure, the forming of colluding groups. For the shards, each of these shards maintain its own address space, so the entire address space is split between these shards and these do not overlap. Then the transactions that are being processed, these are also separate groups of transactions which are being processed by each of the shards, and mainly how we route the transactions is to the senders, where the sender of one transaction is being maintained, so its account. In the shards, we execute the smart contracts. Each of the shards advances its own randomness source used for consensus group sampling, and creates and processes the rewards for validator. Also, there is the creation of fraud proofs, and also the proposer for each block is supposed to also create an erasure coded version of the block and send these parts to the metachain nodes. For the sharding design, this is a simplified model. You can see in the middle the meta chain being produced. Since we allow for forking, so we've tried to improve a bit on the speed of the consensus, but this meant that we had to lose something. So we lose the finality, not the finality, but the yeah, it's actually the finality of a block, so we can we allow for forks to happen. And here you can see a model where, for example, one block was not produced, or there was another block being produced which overwritten a previous block in a certain round, and we have these blocks linked to the meta chain. So meta chain notarizes the shard block headers, but also the shard block headers need to link to the meta chain block which they are currently processing. So this also helps us to keep the shard in line with processing the cross-shard transactions. So a shard cannot advance with processing transaction with processing meta-chain blocks unless it has finished all the cross-shard transactions from the previous meta-chain block. For the data and storage sharding, we based our solution on a hierarchical binary tree model where the tree leaves correspond to shards. And this helps us with deciding where each address is being maintained and also how we need to route the transactions. Also, it helps in deciding which nodes stay in which shard, because as you know, we want to decrease the communication and required to synchronize the nodes with their state. If, for example, we have a split event and then the nodes in the new shards need to know about the previous state so they can work without incurring liveness issues. And also this helps us in forming some model for adaptivity with a reduced cost. So this is the representation of, for example, in A, you see the network starting. Here in this example, MetaChain is out of the picture, so there's still a MetaChain shard. But in figure A, you see there's just one shard, which is responsible for the entire address space. Then in B, there was a splitting event, and the address space has been halved, and half of it is currently being maintained by the new shard zero, and the other half is maintained by the new shard one. And on the right, there's a more advanced in time sharding of the network where you have five shards. Now splitting is easy because all the information is there, and all the nodes which were part of the original shard zero. For example, if we look at figure B, all the original nodes in shard zero already have the state. So when you split them into two groups, they just need to lose some data. There's no communication overhead incurred. But when you try to do merge, then this becomes a problem. So we only allow merging of the last shards that have split, and we prepare for the merging event by having the shards that need to merge synchronize also, or there's some kind of redundancy between these shards, so they need to keep track of the information from the sibling shard. But this only happens on the last shard that split. For creating a new shard, this is a representation of what happens with the blockchain. So you can see the meta chain progressing, and then there's the K epoch split event comes. So it's the first event in the epoch. Also, this is also a checkpoint for the new epoch, so it helps with synchronizing new nodes coming into that. They only need to synchronize from that block forward. So then the other shards, like shard zero, is only aware of the split event after it processes the meta chain block. So we can see there's a delay of one block before the shards enter the new epoch. And you can see that they split, and they need to reference the block where it happened, where the split happened. For the merge event, it's the same thing. MetaChain in the somewhere in the middle. It's first entering into the new epoch. It signals the merge event, and after this merge event is being processed by shard zero and shard two, this then perform the merge. And there's you can see that there are two references to a previous block, so we need to reference both the chains. For transaction sharding, as I mentioned previously, there are different sets of transactions that are being processed by the shards. These transactions are routed based on the address of the sender, actually based on the suffix of the sender's address. But we are trying to improve the communication overhead. So we are grouping the same types of transactions which touch the same sender shard and receiver shard into groups. And these groups are somewhat processed atomically. So you cannot process just partially one of these mini blocks. It needs to be processed completely. And then it's notarized by the meta chain. So the meta chain knows the headers of all these separate mini blocks, and it can so enforce that the destination shard completes the processing of a cross shard mini block before it can progress further with other blocks. The cross-shard transactions or cross-shard mini-block processing is, you can see it in this picture, and there's step one where a mini-block is being created in shard zero, and this mini-block at step two is visible to the meta-chain, and it's already notarized together with the header of the block it came with. And then this needs to be processed in the shard one chain. There's the communication for getting all the transactions that need to be processed for that mini block is done between the two interested shards. So the communication does not go through MetaChain. MetaChain only triggers the event. It's something like whitelisting mini blocks for processing on the destination. And then at step four, you can see the block being processed also in destination. For the network sharding, as we've seen, or this is a problem in all the blockchains, the propagation of messages takes time and consumes lots of bandwidth. Not all messages are of interest to all nodes, so especially when you have sharding, if you have transactions touching shards one and two, this is of no interest to shard zero. And there's also some limitations. For example, if you're using communication through TCP sockets, then there's a limit on the number of sockets one node can maintain. There's also a limit on the number of file descriptors. If you have that in conjunction with a high number of shards, then you start to find out that, for example, you might end up not communicating with anyone. For example, if you're working with lib peer-to-peer and you have topics, then if your node is connected with peers from other shards and not from your own shards, then your messages simply do not get anywhere. And this can also lead to network partitioning. So for example, if you have saturated your connections, then new nodes that come into the network can only connect between themselves. So you can form different partitions of the network. What we've experimented with is cutoff connections with moderate frequency. This was done to limit the connections for a node, but in a reasonable way. And for this, we are using two watermarks, T1 and T2. The first watermark is used to decide when we stop connecting or initiating connections with to other peers. And the second watermark is when we have gone beyond our targeted connections, and then we start trimming the connections. And in conjunction with this, we also need to decide which connections are relevant to us, because you don't want to cut the connections which are relevant to you. So we are using a symmetric connection ranking function, which needs to have several properties. One of those is to have evenly distributed results domain. And also, this function needs to be symmetric for both ends that form the connections. What we use right now is built on top of Kademlia, and it tries to decrease the distance between nodes in the same shard by masking some bits. So these are some experimental results with a few nodes. So as you can see, with 45 nodes, 10 connections, two shards, and one metachain. Actually, here in the drawing, it's called shard 2, the metachain. But you can see with green, the connections that are being formed between nodes in the same shard. And with red is connections between different shards. So what we wanted is to have good connectivity inside the shard, so that messages are going to their right recipients, but also we need to have connections between shards, so that the communication channels between different shards can function properly. For sharding and smart contracts, this is a big issue to talk about, and the solutions currently in the space are less than, let's say, So what we've tried to first categorize the types of smart contracts, and we decided that we would need system smart contracts, and these live on MetaChain. If you think about system smart contracts, think about staking smart contract governance, and we want this to be give information that needs to be propagated to every single shard. So this why this need to live on MetaChain. There's also library or stateless smart contract, and in case there is a call for one of these library or smart contract, we can duplicate this in the shards where they are needed. There's stateful smart contracts, which are assigned to one shard, but in order to improve the throughput in a sharded network, and especially in an adaptive sharding network, you might want to be able to move such a smart contract into a different shard. There's also the case of oracles, which could be duplicated in every shard to provide the external data to the interested smart contracts in those shards. Now, how would the duplication and smart contract movement work? We can use aliases for the smart contract instead of fixed addresses. So this go through a translation. There's a mapping for each alias and where is the current assigned shard. And we have these aliases in a standard format, which is easy to recognize from the account address. And for as I mentioned, for the libraries, this alias would lead you to the current shard, to the smart contract in your current shard. Also, for deployment and balancing, as I mentioned, we want to improve the time for executing smart contract calls. So if you have dependent smart contracts, you want to have this together in the same shard. How we plan to do this is to compute the dependencies upon deployment, because on deployment, you already can flag what are your dependencies, and then you might move this smart contract in or map the alias you already obtained for this smart contract to the right shard. But this cannot become immediately active because you might have lots of communication overhead due to, for example, adding a smart contract which is dependent on two other smart contracts. One of them is in one shard and the other one is in another shard. And this might need to cause the movement of a previously active smart contract into a different shard. So we have these events matching with the start of an epoch, where the dependencies are updated and the movement of smart contracts happen. Also, this movement takes into account the usage of every single shard. So in case, for example, there's a less used shard, you can move a different dependency group into that shard. Beyond scalability, what we found is that even if we solve scalability, this is not really the final answer to adoption. There's also a really important thing is to have a great user experience, a great developer experience, and also a great validator experience. Because scalability, you cannot reach scalability without validators. So what we are working on is to provide good incentives through block rewards for validators, also provide the tools and documentation to simplify the process for running a node, and also provide the channels for community support. For the developer experience and how we are trying to improve this is to provide as well clear and canonical documentation and tutorials. We are trying to support languages that developers are familiar with. This is why we have currently two VMs. One is a Yella VM, which can also run Solidity smart contracts before, so they need to be transcompiled to Yella and then we can run them. And we are also supporting a WASM virtual machine. You need to provide tools for easy development. So we are working on an IDE, which was presented yesterday in a workshop. Also a testing framework and a debugger, which is quite a huge undertaking. Also, even if you provide all these tools and documentation, these are only useful if you continuously support and improve on them. Another part which we try to do is provide ready-to-use smart contract templates. Little by little, one travels far. So lots of the effort we've put into building Arond and all the tools and documentation is starting to converge towards the mainnet launch, which is scheduled for December this year. We are really excited that we are almost, our testnet is almost feature complete. We are currently running also an incentivized testnet where there are around 1,000 validators from the community. I already mentioned about the developer tools which we're working on. There's also a wallet and explorer you can check online. You can also see the current running testnet statistics. We also have our first dApp, which is Crypto Bubbles. It's a competition game. It's a game where you compete with other players. It's really addictive, so you might want to try it out. We're really excited for everyone who's interested in what we're building. So we're waiting to see you engage with us if you're interested. Also to find we find your feedback valuable and thanks. So if anyone has any questions, I can answer. No? Okay, thank you.